Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Always, isn't that true? And how's Kim? Okay. Okay. Okay.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So you might hear it in my voice that this week I've been a little bit sick, but I've been on antibiotics. Don't worry. Got no cooties left. But, since I always have cooties. It's been a great week of resting at home, not going into the office, and just working from home and all that kind of thing. I have some announcements for you today. If you look around, you might see a connection card. If you take that connection card, fill it out. There's some stuff on the back, some questions on the back that indicates you want to tell us something, you want to get a prayer request across to us or something like that. And you can go ahead and put that in the offering basket later on. I wanted to stop here real quick and tell you something that is going on this morning. And that is, yesterday, we all remember Shannon Wise. I point here because she normally sits here. She's been experiencing a lot of pregnancy issues and things like that, so that's why we haven't seen her, a lot of bed rest and all of that. But she contacted me and said, hey, I have this friend who, he's a pastor. His dad went into the ICU unexpectedly yesterday. And he's a pastor of a little church outside of Shelbyville. So she contacted me and said, do you know anyone that could preach for them tomorrow, which was yesterday? And I said, well, let me ask Pastor Jess. She's always ready to go. So I asked Pastor Jess. She goes, oh, yeah, throw me at it, you know. And so she's helping out with a little church outside of Shelbyville. So I ask that you pray for her today. Pray for that little congregation. And it's in a little town called Fairland, So Grace Community Church in Fairland. So there are adopted brother or sister over there. So I ask that you continue to pray for them, pray for her as she delivers God's word today. So announcements for today. Over the last several months, we have been working to rebuild the children's church into a ministry we believe God wants it to be. Presently, we have a leader for 3 Sundays each month, and if you would be willing to lead children's church 1 Sunday a month, or if you would like to be a helper, please get in touch with Pastor Margie. Pastor Margie's at Brookside today, and please pray for Brookside. They've had a little bit of a COVID outbreak there, and I'm sure that Debbie's seen that a lot in hospitals and things like that. Yes.
She had Bible study on Tuesday, and there were only 2 patients with COVID, so it's getting better.
Okay, great. Wonderful. So, speaking of Pastor Margie, she's pretty great, so I'll speak about her again. Today at 2 p.m., please pray for this, because Pastor Margie will be showing the movie Jesus Revolution. A lot of you have seen that movie, to the residents of Brookside. So this is not so much of an announcement as it is a prayer request. So just please pray that the hearts will be open and receptive to the message of Christ presented through this film. So Fortville Church of the Nazarene, our sister church just down the road, is having a revival today through Wednesday. And Dr. Stephen Manley is the evangelist speaking each evening. So, service is tonight at 6 p.m. and at 7 p.m. on Monday through Wednesday. So, check the flyer on the bulletin board for additional information. Midpoint Bible study is every Wednesday at 10 a.m., so don't forget about that. Invite a friend if you're able to make it, if you don't have a job obligation or something else that you have to do on Wednesday. We'd love to have you here in the building at 10 a.m. Everyone is invited. So Lene has something for us as well.
Also, today is Alabaster Sunday, so in a little bit we'll be coming to the front and of putting in our alabaster offering.
Thank you very much.
So as we anxiously anticipate Alabaster Sunday offering, would you stand with us as we begin worship this morning?
I'll give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise.
So, if you have an alabaster offering, now is the time. Bring it on up, jump in the wooden thing, and it's kind of a magical sound of points anywhere. So,
in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come through heaven and earth to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to call on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down. As your people sing, we will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will sing. songs of praise are
to what you have done and in response to who you are. We ask, Lord, that our praise would be acceptable to you this morning, that we would worship in spirit and in truth. God, that you would prepare our hearts and minds for the message you have for us through your servant, Landon. Lord, we thank you for your grace today. We thank you for your kindness. We thank you for caring about us so much that you would leave the 99 to come chase after us. Bring us back. I pray that you would sensitize us to your voice this morning, that as the Spirit convicts us in our hearts, that we would be receptive to that and understand that what's happening. We just take a minute, Lord, to realign, to reorient, to focus in on you. And no matter what we came in with, Lord, I ask that you would help us to take those things to the foot of the cross. Not ignore them, not pretend like they don't exist, but to give them to you. We continue in worship this morning, Lord. We thank you for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Worthy is the Lamb. Sing with us.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Thank you.
Thy presence, I love. Warmest. I'm very good. I love you. I love you. That we get to come to you in prayer because you are the great physician and you know our needs and you care for our needs, whether it is physical, whether it is mental, whether it is emotional, whatever the case may be, you love us and you want us to be whole. Today, Lord, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, we ask that you be with Brenda today as she is facing something that is a little bit concerning, but in anticipating of uncertainty type of way. Lord, we ask that you be with that procedure. We ask that you be with this appointment. We ask that you be with the doctors, nurses, everyone involved, that you will be testified to in the midst of perhaps a little bit of pain and recovery and all of that. But Lord, we know that you are sovereign. And today, Lord, we just ask that you comfort first Brenda, and then we ask that you already pave a way for what is going to happen to bring an amazing testimony and witness to your faithfulness. Lord, we are so excited to hear this testimony after Monday. And Lord, we just anticipate miracles today. Lord, I just ask that you be with Brenda, be with us as a family. In your name we pray. Amen.
Oh gosh, oh yes, sweet, sweet yes.
Anybody else have anything they would like to share today before we get started?
I have to talk again.
I don't know what Mandy is here.
I just want to tell you, I know I talk about it all the time, but this last week we had conversation class on Tuesday, and we had the most students we've ever had, 27, which is, wow, thank you, God. But also, I'm very overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed, like, wow, this is great, but also, I don't know if any of you have ever tried to do a Zoom meeting and move people a million times. It can get confusing. But God, this week was just humbled that God has given me the vision and the wisdom and the team to make this happen so we can reach many people. So Tuesday night we have conversation class. Wednesday morning I do the What Christians Believe study with them. And that number kind of fluctuates as far as the number of people. It's a small group. But what's very interesting is my youngest participant at that Bible study is 9 years old. My oldest participant is 82, 83. And I have a combination of Spanish, Ukrainian, and Russian speakers in that group. And it's just amazing. Every Wednesday I just pray, okay, God, you're going to have to give me the right words. And this last week, we just went through the sinner's prayer. And I don't know the results of that, but a seed was planted with those who need it. And I'm just I'm thankful to be used by God in this way.
I would say that this has nothing to do with my message, but I think it has everything to do with it in some way. I want to say this before I go any further, because I feel like I preach a lot about like how you can have peace and God has a plan for your life and all of those kind of wonderful things that are all 100% true. But sometimes I just don't say it, that we were dead in our transgressions before Jesus came onto the scene. We were hopeless. We didn't have anything that we could offer God. We didn't have anything that we could possibly put at his feet that he would be impressed with. Because of our sin, we expelled ourselves away from God, causing us to head towards an eternity of eternal damnation. But it's because of Jesus and that cross. Well, not that exact one. We didn't go dig it up. But because of the cross that we are reconciled. And it's because of Jesus that we can come to the throne of God unhindered, shaded by the blood, and it's through him that we are saved. So I'm calling on everyone within earshot, everyone on the virtual earshot, let Christ into your life. Just do it. Easy for me to say, I know. But you might be sitting there saying, like, what do you mean? Like, is Christ the way? Christ is the way to salvation. And you might be saying, like, God, why did you limit it to one way? I'm just happy that he gave us a way. Are we all on the same page about that? So speaking of Jesus, I want to talk about him today. I'm starting a series today called Jesus on Mission. So I've been thinking about this a lot, about when talking about the Gospels, talking about the things that Jesus did, the things that Jesus taught. So we have the doing and the teaching, right? I guess teaching is a doing, but you know what I'm saying. But a lot of the times Jesus would say, let me show you what it is to be a part of this kingdom. Now, you show me what I just showed you. It's interesting. He's showing us while he's showing us. He's helping us to do while he's doing. And Jesus came onto the scene, and we see in the Gospels, just did some amazing things. He was healing people. He was healing people by touch, healing people by speech. He was teaching these amazing things. And my question to you, perhaps, is that what did Jesus think his mission was? Did anyone go up there with a microphone and say, Jesus, now I see you out here talking to all these people and healing and all. What's your mission here? Of course, they had microphones back then. Yeah. And what would he have said? So this whole month, the rest of this month, I'm going to be talking about what the evidences we see in Scripture of what Jesus believed his mission was. So Jesus saying it himself, just putting it very bluntly, or Jesus by observation, like, oh, I think that he thinks he is X, Y, Z. So Jesus on mission. So Jesus is on mission. But Jesus on mission in the fact of, like, what did Jesus actually say about what he was doing? It's kind of a play on words there. So, what was Jesus' mission? If you look in a dictionary, you'll see a dictionary definition of the word mission. And it says something to the effect of an important set of actions that one takes that is in line with their particular motivation. So whether that be political, whether that be intrinsic self-motivations, like I want to make myself happy, or if it's an instant gratification, whatever, or religious, perhaps,
But this word mission is a set of actions that someone has, or a direction that someone is going in line with, you know, political, religious, whatever I just mentioned. And then at the end of this definition, it says, and mostly includes travel. And I thought, well, interesting. That for me, when I read that in a dictionary, well, you know, do they even have paper dictionaries anymore? But on dictionary.com, you know, let's say, I thought it was interesting because it read almost like a job description. It may include travel, 20% travel, you know. And I've seen those kind of job descriptions, and I've even posted some of those job descriptions to hire people in the past. May include travel. I think that's really interesting, that little bit. I'm not going to talk about the travel part today, but I thought that was really interesting because sometimes, well, that gives the indication that we can't have just a mission stagnant. But perhaps our mission is, if we're not really highly mobile, maybe it's to move someone else. Yeah. So there's certain animation that happens within our feet and our hands when mission is involved. So, anyway, I think that's really interesting. So mission, this idea that we are in a direction, going in a certain direction, with these motivations in mind. Now, what happens when we add to a word, if we have any English majors out there, Karen Turner's not here today to tell us this, but when we have the word co, there you go, Pam, when we add the word co to something, Pam?
With.
When we add co to anything, community, like with other people, commission, it means mission, what I just described, with. So, in this particular passage of Scripture today, we see something very interesting, that Jesus is starting with the co-mission and going out to do the mission. And when God gives us a mission, it's never a mission. It's a co-mission. I think that's very important to understand. That God doesn't say, good luck, let me know if you need any help. He says, I want you to do this thing, and I will be with you. So God's mission is always a co-mission. So, you ever notice the things that are the most healthy that God gives us have the co in front of it? The community, the co-mission. So, other things, you know, the co, no, I'm just kidding. But God doesn't want us to be alone. We were never created to be in isolation. Like, there's a difference between if you're introverted, I get that. I'm not talking about that today. But what I am talking about is that God has specifically designed us to do his mission with. Whether it be with others, and definitely with him. So here's where we're at in Mark chapter 1. I love the book of Mark because it's written the way I think. If you've ever read the book of Mark, have you ever read these really long stories? It's like, get to the point. My goodness. It's like you're doing all this flowery language. There's no flowery language in the book of Mark. You want to get a gospel that just gets to the point? I'm not saying the other gospels are flowery. Don't get me wrong. But the book of Mark, you see words like immediately and suddenly, all of a sudden, immediately from there. You know, and I'm just like, all right, now we're moving, all right. So we're starting to see different miracles happen, people are healed, teachings happen. This stuff is really exciting, and I just feel like we're just moving on, and things are going great. So this particular story we're jumping in the middle of is right after the baptism of Jesus by John the Baptist. So that particular instance is the commission of Jesus. Okay, you know what you're supposed to do, now go do it. God opens up the heavens, which we'll see here in just a moment, and declares that Jesus is the anointed one, the one, him coming down in flesh, and he has a job to do. But the question is, what is that job?
John actually says a lot. John the Baptist says, here's my job, everyone. This is what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to declare that the Messiah is coming. Oh, there he is. You know, and that's what basically he does. And then John, in other versions of the Gospels, John indicates at, right before he gets arrested for preaching the gospel, he indicates that he wasn't really excited about going into prison, and he was questioning, like, wait, why am I going into prison if I'm doing God's work? Why am I suffering? So there had to be some work done in his heart about that. So he was commissioned. Jesus was commissioned. He was baptized in front of everybody. And this, the Spirit came down like a dove and said, hey, this is the guy. You know, follow him. Listen to what he says. So we're in Mark chapter 1, and we're going to start with verse 9. And this is just, this is after John had come, and now we're focusing in the story of Jesus, right? At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, saying, you are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. At once, the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and the angels attended him. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. So in this story, we see the Spirit of God descending on Jesus like a dove. Hey, this is the guy. This is my son for whom I'm well pleased. So we have that, and I want to put that on the shelf for a second. Then we have over here, we have Jesus going out immediately. That's one of the words from the book of Mark. At once, or immediately, is just very fast. Mark just wanted to get to the point. In other Gospels, we see this whole story about the temptation of Jesus, and perhaps we've even seen the movie about the temptation of Jesus. That Satan gets wind of Jesus and his commission. He knew that this was coming, but maybe not right that moment, and Satan wasn't ready. Okay? Satan wasn't ready. He hadn't had all the plans made. He knew that Jesus was going to be coming. He knew that things were going to be happening. He knew that his adversary was right there, and he was going around doing some, at least starting to lay the groundwork for his ministry. But then he got baptized. Then he went out into the wilderness, and he wasn't ready. So we see in that particular story, that Jesus, right after the commission, right after he was sent out, he was tested. And sometimes we think of tested in the fact of, in the way of, we're sitting down at a table and we're filling out a questionnaire or making sure that we know the stuff. And that, in Scripture, that's not what this means. We say tested when we're saying, I want to make sure that you know what I've taught you. But in all honesty, what was actually happening here was, maybe testing is not the best word. Maybe boot camp would be the best phrase. Maybe that's not the best phrase. But Jesus was going through this instance in which he was strengthening that which God had already put in him. You see, the fact is, the devil didn't stand a chance in this moment. The devil followed him out into the wilderness, started to try to tempt him. Hey, you know, maybe if you throw yourself off of the temple, you know, perhaps you've heard the story. All of these things that could have removed Jesus from being the sovereign authority
in this situation. And the devil was just pulling at straws, trying to figure out, how am I going to stop him from doing this? But the devil's whole mission here was reactive, not proactive. You see, Jesus going out to the wilderness, he says, oh no, I've got to stop him from doing this, because if he gets started, he's not going to stop. And we see that to be true. So the devil wanted everything to stop, but Jesus wanted everything to be put into motion. So Jesus, if you were to ask him in this moment, if you were to send out a reporter and ask him with the microphone, okay, what exactly are you going to do? Like, what is your mission? What are you trying to accomplish here? This is what he would say. He says, I want to tell people that the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. It's a simple mission. Whether it be through his words or through the miracles that we see later on, or you know, whatever healings, or just the simple way that he interacted with people, this was his mission. He wanted to first announce the kingdom of God has come. What is that kingdom of God? We'll find out here soon. He wanted people to repent. What does repent mean? A lot of the times we say that repenting is like, oh God, I'm so sorry. No, that's confession. Whenever you're actually explaining to God what you did so that you can say it out loud, so that you take your accountability for it, that's confession. Repentance is literally that thing that was your sin thing. The thing that you were sinning against, you literally stepped the other way and walked the other way. That word repent there in Scripture literally means to walk the opposite direction or travel the opposite direction of that which you were interacting with. So repenting is actually not just in your head, it's physical. Repentance requires some skin in the game. It requires us to turn around and walk the other direction. Repentance. The good news. So he says, the third thing that we talk about here in this particular passage is this belief in the good news. Again, belief is an interesting word here, because belief doesn't mean just like, oh, I agree with that. But belief actually means that you want to embed it so far in your heart that it affects your hands and your thought processes and everything that you do, the way you interact with people, the way that you spend your money, the way that you walk down the street. Belief literally means that you're allowing God to transform and remold you into something else, and you're just giving up that right to do it yourself. And what is the good news? We've talked about this before. This good news is this declaration of victory. The good news in this context would have been a little strange to hear, because what victory has happened yet? Jesus was baptized. Really cool whole scene there. I haven't seen any miracles or like any really profound teachings yet. We haven't had the beginning of his official ministry per se. But the good news is that which is to come. And in his case, he's not just saying like great things are going to happen, you just watch. Jesus is stepping out in front of everyone saying that I am that victory here embodied in front of you. You don't have to wait anymore. All of these things that you've been talking about for centuries to the Jewish people, all these things that you have been talking about and hoping for and praying for, I am here now and I'm ready to bring it. So immediately, that's the whole flow of Mark. Immediately, Jesus goes out. He says, I need some people. He goes and gets his first disciples. He goes and he starts just doing miracles all over the place. And it's just unbelievable. Jesus was trying to show people that there is power in his name, power in the good news. It wasn't just a thing that we just agreed with and we just said, okay, well, I don't disagree with what he's saying, and that makes me feel good. No, Jesus was saying that you can change the universe through a belief that's not just a thought process. That the King of all creation, the creation that we messed up at the beginning, remember that? That he is coming to make everything new. And to just kind of rewrite everything and let's start over. Because really, ultimately, that's what we're looking at, right? If God is wanting to recreate the same kind of intimate relationship that we had in the Garden of Eden with him, we're rebooting the whole script. It's that new creation, that new beginning. So he starts calling his first disciples. These disciples were not seminary-trained professionals, although they did have a lot of understanding of Scripture, because they all did back then. But these were people who were not high graduates. You know, there's some carpenters, there's some tax collectors, there's some fishermen who still kind of smell a certain way because they're out, they live, no offense, Bob and Pam, but they live out near the water, you know. They, you know, I'm not saying that everyone, but they live in, you know, fish. Okay, you get what I'm saying.
Go on.
But they had a certain look about them. They had a certain way that they spoke. Perhaps they weren't really refined. These people were not normally people that would be made into disciples. But they represented everyone. So these people followed him. And they began to absorb and understand and question and learn. They begin to reiterate what this good news is all about. So what did Jesus feel like his mission was? What purpose did he have? If you were to ask him, he tells us here, he says, well, first of all, you're going to see this a little bit more in the future. I want to tell you that the kingdom of God is here. You don't have to wait anymore. I want to tell you, first of all, I came so that you may repent. And I want you to believe the good news. Someone else that would have been in it for themselves, or some other prophet, or someone claiming to be a prophet who wanted great influence and great wealth and great prosperity and all those kind of things would have come in and said, but for this easy, low price of $9.99, you too could have, you know, would have made it into some amazingly large company or something like that. But Jesus came because he had a mission and a purpose, and he was sent from God. He was God in the flesh, and he wanted people to understand that we can rewrite history. And we now can become reconciled with the one true God. So that is what Jesus thought his mission was. And everything that he did centered around that very mission. He even brought people in with him on the mission. Imperfect people who said things that they shouldn't have said sometimes. Who did things they shouldn't have done. It makes me wonder if maybe God can use us too.
God calls us in commission. We have the same purpose that he does. Whatever part of the universe that we're a part of, whatever skills he's given us, whatever talents or resources he's given us, we're called to that same mission. And he says, I will never leave you or forsake you. I'm going to call the praise team back up today. If you have any business you need to do with God today, perhaps you need to give your life to Christ today, and you've never done that. Perhaps you have been raised as a Christian. Perhaps you have been surrounded by Christianity. You've talked Christianese all of your life. But have you really known Jesus? Have you been so wrecked by him that you've allowed him to take over your life and redirect your path? I'm not talking about a person who just doesn't disagree with what Jesus said. I'm talking about, have you allowed him to just take control? The altars are open here, the edge of the stage. If you'd like to come and pray, if anything else you'd like to come pray about, altars are open. We're going to sing and get back.
Would you stand with us as we reflect on the words that Landon gave us this morning? I have his microphone in front of me. I'm just going to thank you for this morning. The commission piece. Blew my mind. Thank you for that. It's hard to have a mission if we don't have a vision. So as we sing this morning, how appropriate, but this is the song, Be Thou My Vision. Sing with us.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping. I'm
Father, we thank you for today. We thank you that you've given us such a beautiful day. When we look out, we look up into the sky, we see the sun. We are reminded that you look over us. You are with us. You care for us. You comfort us. We are just so grateful that you didn't just write us off, but you did everything that you have done and more, things that we've not even seen, just to reconcile us with you. And today, Lord, if there's anyone within my voice who have not accepted you as their Savior, I ask that you help them to be guided in this prayer. Father, I have sinned, and I am dead outside of your care. Come into my life, cleanse me from within, so that I may be a child of God. Transform me in your will, so that I may be a part of the mission of Jesus Christ in the world. Forgive me of my sins. Help me to be a new creation in you. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. We love you, Lord. We're going to be praying. Amen. Thank you all for being here today. You are dismissed.
Yeah, yeah. I was about to say, like, if you live by the water, like, that doesn't apply.